but here we are seeing only the figures of the GDP. But development is the more holistic one. Hello everyone, welcome to Plutus IS. I'm CA Sonali Jindal. Today we will discuss about the GS economy strategy and we will try to understand the syllabus. And thereafter we will also look into the previous year questions. So to analyze how the questions had been asked from the syllabus itself and how the previous year questions repeated itself. So let's start. But before covering any subject and before reading any of the topic in UPSC, you should ask yourself whether you are here to become some economist or here to clear the UPSC exam. Obviously, there will be ample of the time in the further life where you can read in detail about the some topics. But firstly, you have to see what is the significance of some topic or any subject in the prelims, mains and the interview stage. And let's see. Firstly, we will see how many questions are being asked in prelims from the economics. Here, around 20 to 22 questions being asked from the economy subject. Now you can obviously multiply with the two, you will reach to 40. And you must have seen the cutoffs, recent years cutoffs of the prelims. There you can see it was around 80 to 90 only. So if you were lucky enough to basically solve all the economy questions correctly, then you are able to clear 50% of the cutoff of the prelims. Maybe I think if you have read the economy subject well, then you are being able to comfortably solve around 15 to 16 questions correctly. So 50% of the cutoff can be cleared from the economy subject. Then comes to the mains. In mains, around 8 questions are being asked from the economy. To be very specific, it is being asked in the GS3. And even you can check the question numbers in your recent main papers. There, from question 1 to question 4 is of economy. And even if we segregate these parts, 2 questions from the directly from the economy and 2 third and fourth questions are being asked from the agriculture subject. Then question number 11 to question number 14 are also of the economy. You should also know what is the marks distribution in the mains paper. Obviously, first 10 questions are being asked of the 10 marks and the next 10 questions are of 15 marks. So you can multiply 4 questions of 10 marks each. It comes to 40 marks and the 4 questions of 15 marks each, it comes to 60 marks. So total is 100 marks. And if the GS paper is of total 250, it means around 40% is the basically weightage has been given to the economy. Now, obviously in the interview stage also, you are being asked about the economy situation, economy evolution and various steps being taken by the government. So in the 3 stages, there is a significant weightage has been given to the economy. So it is an important subject. Let's move to the syllabus, which is being given by the UPSC. So prelim syllabus, it is being given only in 3 lines. It shows you the syllabus of economy in the prelim stage. It is not clear. You have to decipher from the basically main syllabus or maybe from the previous year questions. We will also try to understand the syllabus through the diagram itself in the next video. But here, let's see what UPSC says about the prelim syllabus. Firstly, it says economic and social development. So focus has been given to the development. For example, you must have heard the India's GDP is around 6%, 7%. please ignore the fact if you even don't know about the GDP meaning. Later we will take these all these concepts in detail. But now try to understand. If someone says GDP is 5%, next year it is 6%. So there is a growth. But here we are seeing only the figures of the GDP. But development is the more holistic one. Whether we are able to include all the population, whether we are able to remove the poverty from our economy, whether we are able to serve the vulnerable sections. So here the focus has been given on the development. Whether we are able to develop our human resource, whether we are able to give them skill development, whether we are able to give them jobs. So UPSC is not basically focusing on growth aspect more, but it is focusing more on development. Even you obviously know you are not moving to the private sector, you will be serving the public sector. You should know the basic goal difference between the private sector and the public sector. Public sector's goal is to serve the public. Here obviously economy comes because we pay the taxes. There is need of the economies, but obviously government has to see whether that basically profit and loss analysis is helping the sections of the society or not. They have to see it. So they are focusing on the development. In fact, in the development there are two words, economic and social development. So economic terms mein you will see whether the growth is coming or not, whether we are able to create the employment jobs or not. But in the social aspect we have to see whether we are able to include the women section or not. So here the focus is on the social development. Obviously you will also read this in the GS2. Social justice is there in GS2. So in economics they are asking about the holistic development. Then the term is used is sustainable. Sustainable means we should be able to sustain that growth, and that should be able to serve the future generations. For example, if we use any resource today in a such a way that will be exhausted and that will not be helpful to the future generations, will that be development or the growth will be sustainable? Obviously not. For example, if any government is taking the more and more and loan to basically paying the expenses, but later when the future government will come, how it will basically sustain? It will not be able to sustain. Obviously, you know, if you already have the pending loan, you are not able to get the more loan to pay the expenses or maybe to incur any capital asset also. So here we are focusing on the sustainable development. In fact, there the word is also inclusion is given. Even when we will see the main syllabus, there also UPSC has used the word inclusive growth. So growth should be as such that it should develop all the sections of the society. Growth should be as such that it should include all the sections of the society. Growth should be as such it should serve the future generations. So it should be sustainable as well. So why it is basically needed to read the syllabus, although it is not clear, because whenever you will read the newspaper, whenever you will read any other subject, you will be able to decide whether these are helping in sustainable development. For example, if government is focusing on the solar energy, you can obviously think it will help in the sustainable development because it is creating less pollution and it is environment friendly. You can think that way it can be asked in the prelims. Next, it is focusing on the poverty. Although the poverty is being included in the social development, demographics, so basically you also need to read about the population. When you will read the GS1 geography or NCRT of geography, there you will get the information about the population. It gives you the sense, it can ask you about the census. In fact, there are around 50 questions in the previous year questions that are being asked on the census. So only the syllabus is giving the guidance that we have to read about the demographics. For example, any data comes of the IMR, MMR, obviously you can't remember all the data, but census is being conducted after 10 years. This is important for you. At least you should have an idea, somehow idea, how many tribes are there, which tribe has the highest population, density of the population is high in which state or maybe in which district. You should know about it. And in fact, this information will not be, you know, useless. Even if it is not asked in the prelims, it will help you to basically answer in the interview stage as well. Then social sector initiatives, it can be included in the social development. So we have discussed in a detail or every word of the prelims. Let's move to main syllabus. I want to tell you that main syllabus is more detailed, and in fact, if I will also show you the previous year questions, how they are being directly asked on the from the main syllabus itself. Let's move to main syllabus. In prelims, we have seen the word economic and social development, and in the mains, the first word is Indian economy. So here you have to understand the difference between economic and economy. So if you read about the concepts like inflation, demand and supply relation, whatever the theories you read in economics, and thereafter when you apply those theories and concepts to a region or the place, then the word comes the economy. That's why we say Indian economy or the US economy. So when we apply the concepts of the economics to a region or a place, then the word comes economy. Here the very broader word is used in the main syllabus, that is Indian economy. Under this, anything can be asked. In fact, if the government is taking the step towards a digitalization, then that can be asked. If any like scheme or any major project is being brought, if it has the effect on the Indian economy, then it can be asked. The next word is issues relating to the planning. Here the keyword is issues. So whenever you read anything which is envisaged for the planning, there you have to see the issues. That's why the difference between the Niti Aayog and a planning commission can be asked. You should know which are the institutions there are in Indian economy for the planning. It can be related to anything, and for the maybe it could be for the mobilization of resources. So planning related issues you need to see. And if you're like trying to become a bureaucrat, UPSC is obviously not seeing the basically aspirants who are just looking at the challenges and issues. There you have to prepare the way forward and the steps to be taken further also. And the next word is mobilization of resources. In the word resource, you should understand there could be natural resources, there could be man-made resources, and the man itself is also resource. You must have heard the word human resource. So mobilization of human resource could be employment, giving them jobs. So there is a need of better optimum utilization of resources. Why it is needed? Because there are scarce resources. For example, land. You should know the fact that there is 17% of the world's population, but only 2.4% of the world's land. So there is a need of finding the alternatives of land. It could be digital economy, e-commerce is basically why it is promoted. And the other thing is the problems in the land could be resolved by the land reforms. That's why it is being given in the syllabus. In fact, in the modern history, you must have heard about the Mahalwadi system, permanent settled system. You should know about the intermediaries problem in the land, and there is a basically inequality also in the land distribution. There is need to bring the equality in it, and that's why the inclusive growth is also used. And in fact, we have seen the similar thing in the prelims as well. The word is used is inclusion. Thereafter, growth. Here you have to read the factors contributing to the growth. What are the issues in the growth? And in fact, UPSC in the previous years have asked about the potential GDP. it has asked what are the factors contributing to the potential GDP, why India is not able to the potential GDP. You have to see the issues. Firstly, you should know about the factors. So you have to segregate every topic into these topics, like you should see the factors, characteristics maybe, then you should see the issues. You should also prepare the government steps taken in that context and what next can be done. So prepare where forward there itself. Then the word is development, we have seen in the prelims. Then employment, it can be linked to the mobilization of human resource, and employment is directly given in the syllabus. So the types of employment you have to prepare, why there is a unemployment in India, it can be asked, and what kind of employment in the new sectors, maybe circular economy or any renewable sector, you should see. There you should read about the agriculture, industries and services sector. You should know services sector is actually contributing 54% to the GDP, but the employment is very less there. And there in the other sector, if we see in the agriculture, it is employing 48% of the population, but it is contributing only 19% to the GDP. So there is a need of bringing the alternatives of the agriculture, only sector that can absorb the basically human resource from the agriculture, that is only an industrial sector. It is a manufacturing sector. That's why UPSC is asking again and again about the jobless growth, because we have moved from agriculture directly to the services sector there. That is why there is a jobless growth. And in fact, again and again, question has been asked on it. We will see later. So you have to prepare the employment. Then the topic comes is the government budgeting. Obviously at home also, as a maybe जो आप एक बजट बनाते हो एट होम, यू मेक अ बजट लाइक फ्रॉम वेयर द मनी कम्स एंड देन वेयर द मनी दैट हैज टू बी स्पेंड. सिमिलरली गवर्नमेंट ऑल्सो प्रिपेयर्स अ बजट. द मनी कम्स फ्रॉम मे बी टैक्सेस, फाइन्स, और इट कुड बी टेकिंग द लोन. देयर आफ्टर द कम्स एक्सपेंसेस, लाइक इट मे बी पेइंग द वेजेस, सैलरीज टू द पर्सन्स. देन देयर कुड बी एक्सपेंडिचर ऑन द लॉन्ग टर्म एसेट, मेकिंग बिल्डिंग अ रोड, creating a capital asset. That's why here you have to see whether the public expenditure has been made on the short-term assets or the long-term assets, whether the expenditure has been made on the revenue sector or in the capital. Obviously later on we will see into depth. Maybe you are not able to differentiate between the capital and revenue expenditure, but we will see in the depth. Then there comes the liberalization. Here the word directly line is given, effect of liberalization on the economy. Obviously you should know in 1991 government has brought the LPG, that is liberalization, privatization and globalization. Globalization is given in the GS1, it can be asked in GS3 as well. Liberalization is something where you are liberalizing the economy by bringing the foreign sector, bringing the private sector into the industries. You must be knowing that there were very less sectors or industries that were open for the private sector. But later on we bring the liberalization. What was the effect of it? In fact, it can be asked in the Indian economy, but still UPSC has given the direct line of liberalization. You can see the previous year questions that has been asked on this topic, direct the line has been asked. Then the changes in the industrial policies, I have already said, to create the employment there is a need of industrial sector. Industries can contribute to the GDP. Presently we see after LPG also, liberalization, privatization and globalization, industrial sector has not increased to that amount. Currently it is contributing only 27% to the GDP. So UPSC wants you to focus on the industrial sector to see the what are the changes has been brought in the industrial policy. Obviously, in fact, even if you have not started the preparation, you must have heard about the word Make in India. Why the government is promoting the Make in India? because it want to focus on the industrial and manufacturing sector. That's why again and again question has been asked on it, effect of the industrial growth. Already at least you should know how much contribution is being made by the industries. It is around 27%. Then the word comes the infrastructure, because even if we have the land, we have the labor, we have the capital, we have the entrepreneur to work upon it, but the major thing that could sustain any business is the need of infrastructure. Can you think of any factory could be delivering a product without the infrastructure? If there was no road infrastructure, how it can deliver its product? If there was no digital infrastructure, how Myntra can operate? So the focus is on infrastructure. Here the contribution, different infrastructure projects has been given here. You have to prepare at least one page on each of them. So infrastructure, you should prepare what is the need of it, what can be done with it. And there is also a focus on the logistic cost. Logistic cost is currently around 13 to 14% of the GDP. There is has been a contemplation, like if we reduce it to the 10% of the GDP, then exports can be increased by 10%. So if you prepare any topic, you should see what is the impact on the Indian economy, how it will help us. There you can answer your question by thinking about the different sectors, like for example, what is the impact on agriculture will be, what will be the impact on the industrial sector. Then you can write about the services sector, human resource per kya impact padega. Then you can think about the basically topics given in your syllabus, like on the growth, on the development, on the employment. Then the word is given is the investment models. Obviously in the investment sector, you must have heard about the shares, debentures. Here the investment models, like it could be through the corporate bonds, maybe through the angel investors, venture capitalists, maybe public private partnerships. Private sector contributing to the public infrastructure, then there comes the PPP models. So here the focus has been given on the triple P, public private partnership, and numerous question has been asked on it. Then the topic on the agriculture, here also four questions are being appeared in the mains. It's very broad syllabus has been given. You just need to prepare directly the syllabus lines. One is cropping patterns. Here the UPSC has been focusing on the rice wheat system, because it is around 70% of the food crops. Then the focus is on the irrigation system. Obviously irrigation system needs to be sustainable by bringing the micro irrigation, because it reduces the water wastage. And then the agriculture produce, here the word is storage, transport and marketing. Then the e-technology in the aid of the farmers. In the agriculture questions, I would recommend you to think about the stakeholders, like for the farmers, for the rural sector, for the society, how it will help the economy, how it will help the government. Try to like give the dimensions. By this way you can write about the issues and way forward as well. Then the word comes the subsidies, MSP, minimum support price, public distribution system, like you should know about the fair ration shops. Then the word is economics of the animal rearing. So it is focusing on the livestock sector, maybe milk production, or then the food processing industry. Food processing industry is important because I have already said the only sector then can create the bridge between the agriculture and services sector is only the industry. If we take the raw material and process it further, it will come into the secondary sector. Food processing industry is a called to be a sunrise sector. It can produce numerous jobs. Then the supply chain management, how the full supply chain works, you should also read about it. So we have seen the mains and prelims syllabus into the detail. Hopefully it will help you. Keep preparing it. And I want to summarize my conclusions into this thing. You should prepare basic concepts, then you should move to the previous year questions so that you can drive the themes from which you can prepare. And the most important part comes is the practice. You have to solve prelims questions and solve mains questions as well. Thank you.